Thank you very much for the introduction. It's a huge honor to be here and presenting to this audience, and receiving an honorary doctorate at your institution is just a huge honor for me, so thank you. Today, I'm pleased to have the opportunity to tell you about my research work. The focus, the disease, is called osteochondrosis, also in the medical literature known as osteochondritis dissecans, and sometimes abbreviated as OCD. This is a disease of growing animals and humans, and it results in a cartilage or cartilage bone flap that forms in joints. I'll show you an image of that in a minute. It's a very important disease in pigs, the most common cause of lameness in swine, and a lame pig is essentially a dead pig, because these animals can't live with the disease if they can't walk. So people don't do surgery in pigs as they do in other species. It's also a very common disease in horses and dogs, and less common in humans, but very well recognized by orthopedic surgeons. This is what the disease looks like grossly. This is a typical lesion in a pig, and the lesion is occurring in the typical predilection site, which is the medial aspect of the distal femur. And we can see this area that looks a little bit opaque. The cartilage looks opaque, and in fact, a piece has broken off and dislodged into the joint. This is a very painful lesion once that underlying bone is exposed, and the fragment can wander around in the joint and cause locking. Very common symptom in humans. To understand the disease, you need to understand a little bit about how bones form, because this is a disease of growing individuals. All of the long bones in the body initially are formed entirely of cartilage, and over time, during usually in utero development, the shaft of the bone becomes vascularized, vessels ingrow, and that tissue becomes ossified or turns to bone. At a later point in development, the ends of the growing long bone, which here are entirely cartilaginous, then become invaded by vessels and bone forms here. So this shaft of the bone is known as the primary center of ossification, and the ends of the growing long bones, that's where the secondary center of ossification forms. In between that secondary center and primary center is the growth plate, and that's responsible for longitudinal growth of the bones. The secondary center of ossification is responsible for forming the shape of the growing long bone. So in the adult, the cartilage is completely replaced by bone, leaving only articular cartilage. So osteochondrosis is a failure of that process. And just to show you in normal development, again, from a horse, here's the distal end of a growing long bone that's composed entirely of cartilage. That's in the 6-month fetus. By 10 months, we see that the secondary center of ossification is formed. And we can perhaps you can even visualize blood vessels in this cartilage. It will all be converted to bone except for the very surface articular cartilage. Osteochondrosis in humans was first described in the 1800s, first by Sir James Paget, who wrote a paper called On the Production of Some of the Loose Bodies in Joints in 1870. This described several patients with cartilage flaps in their joints. A little bit later, Franz Koenig first introduced the term osteochondritis dissecans. That was in 1888. But we know the disease occurred long before it was described by these individuals. This is tissue from an archaeological museum in Croatia. This is a subadult or growing, like a teenage human, from the 9th century AD. This individual had bilateral disease. Both of the distal femurs had this defect. In one, the cartilage, now it had formed bone, that fragment was present and fits neatly into that defect. We can see that radiographically as well. The fragment from the other side was lost. But here is perfectly bilaterally symmetric disease in a young human from the 9th century AD. In veterinary medicine, the Scandinavians were the leaders, and they are to this day. I count myself as an honorary Scandinavian because my roots are from Sweden. The first report from Grandelin in 1974, he described osteochondrosis in pigs. Shortly after, Sven Raelands, PhD, focused on osteochondrosis in pigs. This was at the Veterinary College, which was then located in Stockholm. His advisor, Sten-Erik Olsen, also wrote or edited a book on osteochondrosis in domestic animals. Sten-Erik Olsen deserves special mention. He's a legendary figure in this disease. Interestingly, he held both medical and veterinary degrees. And also importantly, he was the first to suggest that the pathogenesis of this disease was the same in humans and animals. And I remember many years ago reading his articles, and I thought he was exactly on track. And you'll see that I've spent 30 years trying to prove this premise. I believe, as Virchow did, that between animals and human medicine, there's no dividing line, and there shouldn't be. And this shows that lesion in the growing pig adjacent to the human specimen. The lesion is in the identical location, and this is the number one predilection site for the disease, both in pigs and humans. So already we have pretty good evidence that the disease is the same. So in the, 1986, I think, was my PhD thesis. This is not just to show how unprofessional the front page of a thesis from the US looks like compared to one from Sweden, where you publish a book and it's really lovely, but also to show in close chronological time, Stina Ekman here, at the College of Veterinary Medicine here, published a thesis, and our titles were almost identical. We were in two different countries studying the same disease and thinking about it very similarly. So one day, a couple years after I finished my thesis, I got a package in the mail, and it was this thesis from Stina Ekman. And she had said that she had read my work and cited it in her thesis. And I was just thrilled. I wrote back and said, all of my great-grandparents came from Sweden, some from Småland, some from Värmland. And I was just, it was thrilling to hear from someone from Sweden who had such similar interests to mine. So a couple years later then, Stina Ekman sent me a message and asked if I would like to come to Sweden and write a book chapter with her. Sten-Erik Olsen provided the funds, and I did that, and we published this chapter in 1998, a kind of summary of the disease. We both had noted that prior to the development of the cartilage flaps, there were subclinical lesions that are not visible grossly. This is the distal end of a femur that's affected, but the articular cartilage is perfectly smooth and intact. But if you cut a slice through that bone, you will see that there is these areas of retained cartilage. This should be a smooth arc. This is bone, cartilage, and instead we see retained areas of cartilage. And you can also visualize that radiographically. But the surface of the tissue is completely normal, so it's an occult or hidden lesion. We also knew from other publications that the cartilage of the secondary center of ossification is vascularized, and this shows this nicely. This is the distal end of the femur, the condyles of the femur. Here's the secondary center of ossification. Again, histologically, here's the growth plate. And all the holes in that cartilage actually represent blood vessels. If you perfuse and clear the intact specimen, this is what you see. The cartilage is clear, and these are blood vessels entering from the perichondrium into the cartilage. And you can see they both enter both from the abaxial and axial aspects. There's an area centrally that is not vascularized. And also you can note that these vessels don't form connections with each other. They're end vessels, similar but much smaller than the coronary arteries. So they are vulnerable to damage. If we cut a slab through this tissue, we can see here's the bone, cartilage. The overlying articular cartilage has no vessels, but the growth cartilage that will be replaced by bone is very diffusely and heavily vascularized. And we can see the vessels arise from the margins and enter the cartilage and branch, And as the ossification front proceeds towards the articular cartilage, it overcomes these vessels, and they must form a new source of blood supply. So they form connections to vessels in the bone. It is this process and this site that fails in osteochondrosis. In pigs, and this is pretty much in every domestic pig, we can see what happens as they mature. We're going to focus on the left side of each of these images. In the 11-kilogram pig, we see, and you've seen this image before, diffusely vascularized and no lesions. But by the time the pig weighs 27 kilograms, we can see that the vessels, these axial vessels, are lost. You see they're here and absent here. If we cut a section through that site, we can see that we see a corresponding area. This is an area of necrosis of cartilage. I'm going to quickly show you that in higher magnification. The articular cartilage is intact, and we have this very well demarcated area of dead cartilage centered on dead or necrotic blood vessels. Once the pig reaches a weight of about 50 kilograms, and this is just a little different preparation, so the vessels are orange instead of white, but same process, we see there's very few remaining vessels. They're only present out in the extreme abaxial areas. And here we see a stair step of lesions. These are areas of cartilage necrosis that formed sequentially over time. The lesion, I should have mentioned, when it's completely within the cartilage and not visible radiographically, we call this osteochondrosis latens. Once the ossification center, once the bone reaches that tissue and there's a delay in ossification, that's known as osteochondrosis manifesta, and we can see that lesion radiographically and grossly. I might mention any pressure, normal or abnormal, on the surface of the cartilage with this huge underlying lesion can result in collapse because the necrotic tissue is not as strong as normal tissue. The surface collapses and you get a cleft through the articular cartilage. And that's what happens in the disease osteochondrosis dissecans. This stage of the disease is clinically evident. It's painful. We can see histologically the cartilage flap. Over time, this may ossify. This happens in humans because the disease, once it's first diagnosed, they usually wait even a year or two before they do surgery, at which time that tissue flap is bony, and it actually looks like a bone fracture, but it is not. There's actually a thin layer of necrotic cartilage lining that gap, and it will not heal without surgery. So this is what this grossly represents, this cartilage flap or cartilage and bone flap that in this case has completely detached. Early in my postdoc work, I attempted to recreate the disease by transecting the blood vessels, so cutting the vessel supply and seeing if I could reproduce the disease. This was a kind of clumsy, you'll see, as compared to the people who did this later, but we actually drilled into the cartilage in an area that was well vascularized in young pigs, filled the moat with bone cement, and then serially sacrificed the animals and examined this interior area, which now should be devoid of blood vessels. And in fact, 6 days after the surgery, here's that central core of tissue. The dark area in the middle is an area of cartilage necrosis, which by 24 days after surgery, the entire interior area is dead or necrotic. So we did succeed in killing the cartilage by interrupting blood supply. Around that time, I heard from Dr. Ekman again and asking me to participate in a committee of a graduate student at the Norwegian Veterinary College, Bjørnar Itrehus. Some of you probably know him. And this is his PhD thesis. I'll just show you a little bit of his work, an early photo of he and I, and here is at his thesis defense photo with Stina. In the first chapter of his thesis, Bjørnar reproduced what I had done in pigs. He sacrificed animals serially as they grew and saw exactly the same pattern of vessel supply, a well-vascularized tissue in the very youngest animal, progressive loss of vessels accompanied by areas of cartilage necrosis as the animals grew. And this, it's one of the most satisfying kind of findings of my scientific career that 10 years after my work in a completely different country, a different set of animals, my results were absolutely perfectly reproduced. It was really, when I was doing my work, people said the pigs all have to come from the same farm, and I couldn't get them all from the same farm, and it turns out they don't have to be from the same farm or the same country, they just have to be pigs, and you will see this lesion. So very well reproduced since. Bjørner also reproduced the lesions a little bit more elegantly than I did. Instead of creating the circular lesion, we noted the vessels were coming from the periphery, so he just made a slit into the cartilage to interrupt the blood supply, a little less invasive, and he did produce. I'm just really showing briefly some of these results, not the details, but he did reproduce lesions of necrosis in those areas. Following Bjørner's work, Kristin Olstad was the next Norwegian veterinary student. She was very interested in studying osteochondrosis in horses, and which was important, and she studied multiple sites. The disease occurs in specific predilection sites, and they vary a bit by species. At the time, the horse researchers felt that the disease was different in horses. It wasn't the same disease in pigs. The pathogenesis was different. The problem was they were looking at animals that were too old. By the time they were examining the tissues, the vessels were gone, so they didn't see vessels. So Kristin solved that problem. She looked at very young animals. In the first couple weeks of life, you see a very interesting process that really is the same as in pigs. And this is one of her perfused specimens. We're looking at a predilection site of disease in horses. And here she's pointing out that the articular cartilage has no vessels, but the growth cartilage is very well vascularized. Just a couple weeks later, in that same site, a different animal now, we see the area, the avascular area, that corresponded to an area of necrosis. So she showed in multiple sites that the pathogenesis was the same in horses and pigs. And to me, this was a really important step towards proving the disease in humans. If you can show it's identical in two animal species, you're yet a step further toward proving this in humans. Kristin also reproduced the disease in ponies. Ponies do not develop osteochondrosis naturally, and she even more elegantly than the first two people who did these studies recognized from cleared specimens that the vessels in the perichondrium then entered into the cartilage, so she could cut the vessels in the perichondrium and not have to enter the joint, which was another a very elegant piece of work. And she did successfully reproduce the disease in foals. The foal that lived the longest was 42 days after surgery, and this is not the same site as you saw previously, but the same lesion where we had collapse. I'm not showing the histology, but there's an area of necrosis beneath this and an area of clefting, perfectly reproducing the clinical disease, which was the first time that had ever been done experimentally. Kristin also did a large amount of work looking at lesions by CT in pigs. And here you see a femoral condyle and this area of lucency on CT that perfectly corresponds to this multi-lobed area of necrosis. In 100% of these lesions, she saw the areas of necrosis. So in every case. So more and more, we were thinking that this disease mirrored what was seen in humans. We wrote a review article focused on the clinical aspects of the disease in humans and animals, noting that in both humans and animals, this is a disease of growing individuals. The clinical signs and symptoms were very similar. The onset of those symptoms often are associated with athletic activity as horses go into training or as children start soccer and they're kicking and get it in their elbows when they throw. The disease occurs in both, in all species, in a bilaterally symmetric fashion. It's managed similarly, the predilection sites are similar, and the gross and radiographic appearance of the lesions is similar. And this just shows one example in a human. This is a femoral condylar lesion. This area, it looks like a piece of bone has been detached. We know now that this lesion occurred during growth when it was composed entirely of cartilage and then ossified. But if you're only seeing it for the first time when the person has symptoms, you think, well, this looks like a bone fracture. By CT, the identical lesion in the identical location in a horse. At that point, we wondered where to go next, and we're at the University of Minnesota. We have a very much state-of-the-art MRI center, so we thought perhaps we could collaborate with scientists there and develop techniques to visualize both the vessels and the areas of necrosis in vivo. If we could do that, we could follow the disease over time in an individual animal. We also thought we could use this to prove that the pathogenesis was the same in humans and animals. If we can prove the primary lesion in humans occurs secondary to a defect in blood supply, this would be, we thought, that last piece of proof to show the same pathogenesis. So quickly, I'm just going to show you the femur. This is a high field. It was a 9.4 Tesla magnet. We imaged the tissue and then did the corresponding histology. And we can see the vessels are pointed out in red, and we can see exactly the location of the vessels that correspond histologically to the MRI image. We also induced lesions in goats, so we knew exactly where the lesions should occur, and in fact produced this lesion, a latent lesion. It's still up in the cartilage, and we can see using the T1 row sequence that area of kind of increased relaxation time that perfectly corresponds with the lesion of necrosis. A little bit later stage in time, this is the ossification front. It's proceeding toward that lesion. There will be a delay as the ossification front reaches the lesion. And in fact, 9 weeks after surgery, that is what has happened. Here's the area of necrosis, and we can see that there's a delay in endochondral ossification. So we can experimentally now reproduce the lesions and then demonstrate them by MRI. So right around this time, we were finding all these exciting things, and a review came out in Clinical Orthopedics and Related Research, which is a very well-known human clinical journal, orthopedic journal. And this was a review of knowledge in osteochondritis dissecans from Koenig, who first described the lesion in 1888, to this is a group of physicians studying research on osteochondritis dissecans of the knee. It's an international group. And their conclusion was, despite more than a century of study, we've made little advancement. They did not read the veterinary literature, and they were not getting anywhere when focusing on the human clinical disease, basically. And that was also followed the next year by the two co-chairs of this ROC group, saying, in the realm of children's orthopedics, there are a few enigmatic pathologic processes that challenge us more than this disease. And they again repeated, we haven't learned anything in over 100 years. So at that point, I actually emailed these two individuals and said, you know, we think we've done quite a bit in veterinary medicine. You know, I'd love to meet with you or talk with you more about that. They invited me to give a talk to their group. And since that day, I've had a conference call every month with Kevin Shea. He's very much on board. And he had access to a source of human tissues that he has shared, so now we were able to do our studies in humans as well. So just going back to this, the pig, the human, we did our MRI studies. This is 1-month-old human, 3-month-old human distal femur compared to similar stages of development in pigs, and we can show that the vessel supply in humans and pigs is nearly identical at this predilection site. Very important. We also showed in humans as they age from 4 months to about 3 years that they begin to lose their vessels in the predilection site, this axial area, the femoral condyle, exactly as the pigs did. Also, we thought this was important. Yes, this is a video, MRI video from a 1-month-old human femur. The secondary center of ossification is the center. The rest of the tissue is composed of cartilage. The articular cartilage has no vessels. You can see here, but you can see the dense vessel supply supplying that entire distal femur. Going back to this lesion now, we said if this is true in pigs, if we could examine these tissues now and by CT and look at the lesions in humans, what will we find? And this paper is just, we got the galleys about a week ago, it's just coming out now, where we've identified this is a femoral condyle from a 7-year-old human male. We see this nice lesion by CT, never previously investigated, and it corresponded perfectly to an area of cartilage necrosis that's the cause of that defect. And this just shows higher mag of the dead chondrocytes and then the repair tissue adjacent. We also very recently looked at biopsies from predilection sites in these human tissues and identified the first osteochondrosis latent lesion. This is the articular cartilage and artifactual cleft. You need to ignore that and focus on the arrows, which is pointing out next to a degenerate blood vessel, this very well demarcated area of necrosis. So this paper, again, it's online, but in draft form, so I couldn't capture an image. The title is Juvenile Osteochondritis Dissecans of the Knee as a Result of Failure of Blood Supply to Growth Cartilage and Osteochondrosis. And we dedicated this paper to the memory of Professor Sten Erik Olsen and his student, Dr. Sven Raeland, who were the first to suggest that osteochondritis dissecans was the same disease in humans and animals. So we conclude 40 years after it was first hypothesized by Sten Erik Olsen and Sven Raeland, we've demonstrated the presence of these subclinical lesions in humans that are identical to those in animals. And we believe that provides strong or even irrefutable evidence that the disease in humans and animals has a common pathogenesis. And I would just summarize by saying my 30-year collaboration with Scandinavian researchers has been extraordinarily successful and has allowed me to do things that I could not have done on my own. So just to show the team, we have veterinarians on our team. You'll recognize Dr. Ekman, Bjørnar Ytrehus, Kristin Olsted, Kristin's advisor, Niels Ivar Dolvik, who's a large animal surgeon in Oslo. Ferenc Tote is also a large animal surgeon who works with me at Minnesota. Our MRI experts from the Imaging Center at the University of Minnesota. And a group of orthopedic surgeons, notably Dr. Kevin Shea, who was my first contact and was able to provide the human tissues. Dennis Cloese is the chair of the department at Minnesota and has helped fund this work and just kind of believed that what we were doing was important, and sometimes that's the most important thing. We're currently funded by various grants from the NIH and also money from orthopedic surgery. So that's my presentation. I'd be happy to answer questions if you have questions.